The title of the lecture is Fascism and Imperialism, one of several promising approaches to analyzing what fascism is, defining it, and also figuring out what to do about it. So I walk you through the list of criteria that Georgi Dimitrov gave in 1935 in calling fascism the most aggressive form of imperialism, a sign that capital or the bourgeoisie, terms that he would use interchangeably, the economic ruling class in a commodity producing society, pursues strategies to set the political system in accordance with their class interest. And of course, this is never a straight cut thing. You always have people who make up their own mind. There is always the Warren Buffett who says, I do want to be taxed at a higher rate for every 10 billionaires who are saying slash taxes, and that will fix the economy. But by and large, there is a way in which the system as such functions, or in this case, malfunctions. So whenever there is a crisis and you have a parliamentary democracy, freedom of speech, and so forth, and the common people use this, the working class makes use of these liberties and of these rights to make demands that will cost money and that might weaken the national bourgeoisie vis-a-vis others, that is when it becomes tempting to bring down the hammer and withdraw some of these rights and liberties. And we saw that it's a gradual process as it developed in Germany. The communist newspapers were shut down or fined. Communist rallies were outlawed or repressed with police violence, including actual casualties, and so forth. And just like today, it is always entirely one-sided, not because the police are somehow in the same boat as the neo-Nazis, although that is in many cases also true. For instance, the cop who was part of the rallies against the tower before the Adventure Church in the Tower Theater here, who a friend of mine was able to trace with her detective skills to the Fresno Police Department, and he subsequently lost his job. No, but it's also a question that the neo-Nazis are in the game for stabilizing the system and the power structure as it exists. So when people look at the disruptiveness of fascism and fascist street politics and rhetoric and so forth, they are often struck by this being anti-bourgeois. If you're talking in a cultural sense, middle-class sensibilities are evidently deliberately violated by the Nazis, by fascists in their political appearance. So that led people in the 1920s and 30s to misjudge what fascism was all about. And Dimitrov here cites a number of these who are saying this is a movement that is about one particular group of declassed members of society who are not middle class anymore, who don't want to be members of the proletariat, who really can't fathom the thought that they've been reduced to wage workers and they're not better than the people they used to look down on as a result of the crisis. So fascism gives them a way of articulating their anger. Sure, it might do that, but is that really what fascism is essentially? Is that what defines it? Or others who argued that in fact, fascism is something that is above the class struggle. It is truly state power rising to where a bourgeois state or a monarchy never could, to really become a complete detached power from the social conflicts. And rather than take them all on board, suppress them all equally, and impose some sort of abstract general will as defined by the leading party and the Führer. That too is not the case, because if you look at the practice of fascism in power, as much as it might have been anti-bourgeois in the cultural sense, like against middle class sensibilities, and as much as it might have been anti-capitalist in articulating and giving voice to the disruptions caused by capitalist crisis, once in power, the ruling class remains the ruling class. The people in society who have power, who have economic power, who call the shots, that does not change. And what fascism does once in power is to implement what these groups, the economic ruling class, has been asking for all along, but didn't get. It may be distinct from the liberal state that merely serves as a committee of the bourgeoisie to run their common political affairs, to quote Marx. But if it doesn't stop there of just being a pragmatic, caretaker of the interests of the bourgeoisie, of serving as a ideal common capitalist, if it doesn't stop there, it goes beyond it. So it takes all the ideologies where capitalism creates a desire for repression of the self and of others that is rooted in necessities, for sure, that come out of the production process in the capitalist system, but are taken way past the any sensible target. So to say that you have to apply yourself, work hard, be on time, be disciplined, etc., to hold down a job in a capitalist society is certainly functional advice. That is a minimum condition. To say that people who succeed in a capitalist society therefore can be assumed to have had a good work ethos is not necessarily true, because you can be born into wealth. It is also not necessarily true that somebody who is poor therefore lacks the moral righteousness to work hard. And all the further you go, the more derived notions you get from that one initial connection to real life, the more you enter the terrain that fascism then really takes hold of and runs with. So the next step is, most people who are poor are morally inferior. Most people who are morally inferior seem to belong to certain groups that can probably be defined by their biology. Isn't it odd how most people governed by Democrats are dirt poor, dirty, and populated by immigrants and Black people? Isn't there something that is inherently filthy and poor about people with that kind of skin color? And so then at that point, you base policies on this assumption. You say, if I am elected, I will really make sure that these people are going to have to go and work for themselves again, rather than just living off your tax dollars. And if they don't, we have means and ways to deal with them. So there is no remaining barrier from this kind of biological definition of one group of people as inherently inferior to mass extermination. There is just a sliding scale. I don't want to say slippery slope, because you do get, you rarely get people getting caught up by their conscience. You do get the awareness that if you do this, you're actually committing a crime against humanity. So you really need to know that you're going to get away with it and not be caught. That's more likely. Presumably somebody in the Rwandan genocide said to one of the perpetrators or bystanders who had some sort of power that eventually there is going to be a report in the Western press about it. And then what are you going to do? What are you going to tell them what you did when this happened? So this, if nothing else, might eventually be what is stopping this runaway train of thought that begins with a perfectly sensible statement. I guess if you really want a job, you're going to have to work hard. And then, you know, and these are necessities under a capitalist society. There is a possible logical chain of reasoning that leads from this to the Holocaust, with very little exaggeration. So what Dimitrov then is saying to social democrats and socialists who have been characterizing fascism as something that declassed, not fully class conscious proletarians or failed shopkeepers and former white collar workers who now have to become wage workers do to make themselves feel better by looking down on people who are racially other or on the actual working class, that is mistaking one of the symptoms perhaps for the essence of it. The essence of it is this is a matter of a political project by the bourgeoisie, for the bourgeoisie, and of the bourgeoisie. Now, some people, and this is an argument mostly to engage the left, people who already are convinced that we're dealing with a system where political and socioeconomic power is in the hands of the owners of capital, you get the argument, but doesn't the bourgeoisie already rule in a liberal democracy? Well, yes, of course it does. That's the whole point. I cited Reinhard Kühne. Both liberalism and fascism are forms of bourgeois domination, but they nevertheless are not different ways of organizing bourgeois rule as represented by, say, a transition of power from social democrats to Christian democrats or democrats to republicans or vice versa. So it is not just the same state system governed by a different party with a slightly different emphasis on the interests in society, but rather it is a completely different form of state. It stands on its own among other forms of state, such as a republic, a monarchy, a theocracy, and so forth. So it is nevertheless, in terms of the class character of it, still a way of making sure that the state serves the purpose of guaranteeing that the owners of capital can valorize that capital by investing it in finance, production, agriculture, and whatnot, and maximize their loot in the process. So, and if and when liberal democracy leads to a government where there are social democrats in it who are saying you have to pay 0.25 percentage point more in contribution to the retirement plan and the health insurance plan, as was the case in Germany in 1930, then a majority of that social class will often say, well, that's it. This is the end of the line for us when it comes to democracy. It had its chance, it doesn't work for us. Let's try something else. People will also point to the fact that fascists don't always speak German, goose step, wear Nazi uniforms, and look like caricatures from the movies. Even in the 1930s, not all fascists were the same. And in some cases, there were conflicts over specifics of the ideology. There were also just simple resource conflicts. I mentioned, for instance, Leon de Grey, who was the Francophone, the French-speaking Belgian fascist leader, who never got any traction with the German Nazi occupation authorities because they already had a Dutch-speaking Nazi party that they much preferred. So when it comes to that region, when it comes to Belgium, if you want to totally dominate that whole place, and you have two different groups who want that, then you have to pick your side, you know, and the French-speaking ones weren't it. In other places, you have basically precursors to fascism, like the arch-conservative, deeply reactionary Austrian government under Chancellor Dollfuss, clerical fascists basically, already repressed the working class. They shot at social democrats and communists and so forth. So, and yet These were the people running Austria when the Germans invaded the country.
There may be places where it is even possible to maintain a parliamentary system with varying degrees of opposition and the competitiveness of the elections. In the case of the United States, you have had multi-pronged attacks on democracy on top of having a system that constitutionally is minimally democratic to begin with. It is by design geared towards refining rather than representing the people's opinion through the Senate, through the House of Representatives, through the proportions between the states that factor in, that don't factor in as much the population, so as to privilege smaller, more rural states over more populous ones. On top of that, then, you get massive efforts, successful efforts, to reduce the number of voting people in a targeted fashion, to remove working people and Black people mostly, but also students from out of town in states that have a Republican majority from the voter roll. You have gerrymandering of districts, as a result of which Democrats would need upward of 56% of the popular vote nationwide for a majority in the House of Representatives, whereas Republicans need 45%. You have election denialism. You have mobs that show up at polling places to say, stop this deal, recount. This cannot possibly have gone with, this cannot possibly have been a legitimate result. Let's look at all those kinds of people who were allowed to vote here. There were buses brought in of, you know, your minority here, Native Americans, Black people from South Central LA, recurring themes in these arguments against democracy about election integrity and so forth. Let's say here were people who shouldn't have been voting, and almost always it's a matter of low income or non-white. Nevertheless, it is hard to imagine a picture where Congress would be abolished, say, or where the Democratic Party, well, it is easy to imagine a scenario where most of the leadership of the Democratic Party or membership will be sent to Guantanamo Bay. If the January 6th insurrection had its way, of course, they would have taken their picks of people to hang on the spot and others to simply arrest and send away. So you always get the occasional person who sends out bombs or envelopes with anthrax or whatever to lists that match pretty closely the rogues gallery that is presented on right-wing propaganda news, where, you know, these are the people who are coming for you and your children. They are a danger to you. They never say and therefore go out and threaten their lives, but people know what to do without these specific instructions. So all of this, there is a question of whether there needs to be a tipping point where fascism is already, before that you can say there was no fascism, and after that you can say now there is. If Mr. Trump had had his way and called out tanks to take care of Black Lives Matter protesters, that probably would have been a clear marker. He didn't get to do that because there were enough people within the military who resisted that. But in Portland, for months, in Portland, Oregon, for months, you had a reign of terror of the Department of Homeland Security picking people up in unmarked vans and disappearing them, executing people who were unarmed, like one guy they were looking for a shooting, a protester who had been accused of shooting a neo-Nazi who had come to provoke violence at one of those rallies. When the federal authorities caught up with him, they shot him multiple times on the spot, no questions asked. So
and were praised for that by the political leadership at the time. All these kinds of things are obviously stuff that you would expect in a fascist dictatorship, as is 99% of things ICE does, immigration and customs enforcement, a racial special police, if ever there was one. Nevertheless, as law, I don't know if that's the only good criterion, if you can still sue against that. Maybe you can call it fascism. But there is also an important distinction to be made between practices that would fly in a fascist dictatorship, ideas that define fascism, and having a fascist party in government, fascist policies pursued by government, and having a fascist state. So at what point is it really that you can say, this is your July 4th, 1776, end of monarchy, beginning of republic, declaration of independence. You get such a point. In Germany, in hindsight, we can say, yes, probably the Ermächtigungsgesetz was that time, when Hitler was given full dictatorial power. But of course, he was given that power under the existing constitution, and the existing constitution was never scrapped. So some people probably saw it, that this was that point, that tipping point. But many still were under illusions that this was nothing in particular, and it wouldn't last that long, and surely they would run out of steam, and so on and so forth. So if and when it happens, whether you're going to know it or whether you're going to know it in hindsight is an open question. What it will look like is an open question. But what is clear is that it doesn't have to look like Germany to be proper fascism. And of course, the symbolism, the language, especially among the paramilitary wing of the Republican Party, the marches with torches, which is a direct quote from the neo-Nazis. Richard Spencer shouting, "Hail victory," which is a direct quote from the Nazis. The positive reference to the America First Committee, which is also a direct line of tradition to the American allies of European fascists. All of these steps, you can say, are aimed at normalizing, preparing, and creating almost like an urge for fascism. Because remember, what the Nazis did in Germany was to create a crisis, to create a sense of crisis politically. It was bad enough with the economic crisis after 1929. But it didn't require that. They were already at it before that. And they built up this vision of a country between hostile forces within and without. So on the outside, you have the Jewish world conspiracy, or globalism, as they say today. Not the Elders of Zion, but the World Economic Forum and George Soros. On the other hand, from within, you have the hapless, witless, or in part, you know, outright evil and knowing supporters of this menace. And there needs to be one group that has to step outside of the narrow circle of liberal, democratic, bourgeois norms to get that job done. Who else can do that but fascists? I want to, this particular thought, that the awareness that yes, this is not the norm, these are extraordinary measures that we're taking, but somebody needs to do it. Not everybody is cut out for it. It needs somebody with the right kind of ruthlessness. And hey, aren't we lucky to have somebody like that at our disposal right now, who doesn't play by the rules. In the words of David, what's his face? Victor David Hansen, Fresno State professor of classics and now a global spokes preacher for the fascist revival, his spiel has always been to link things to his one era of expertise, which is, you know, classical antiquity. So after many, many years of saying Obama is an example of what happens if a republic is in decline, and the Roman Republic shows us what that looks like. He looks at Trump and says, and here is a classical hero, somebody who doesn't play by the rules, who therefore does what's right and does what's needed. And this is, of course, also, especially for the classically educated, for that upper middle class that constitute the bulk of fascist support, something they know from the books, from the grammar schools, from the universities. The classical, you even find it in Hegel, if you recall, if you read Hegel, the philosophy of history, the hero is somebody who channels the world spirit, who drives history forward towards more reason and freedom and so forth. Except in this case, it is the hero that saves Western civilization by slashing at the undergrowth of freedom, equality, and other alien ideas that have grown on that healthy soil, that restores the breathing room by ruthlessly hacking and slashing their way through that alien, you know, invasive species of ideological plans, as it were, like freedom, equality, and so forth, and replace them with good old Germanic values like loyalty, fealty, obedience, honor, and you know, you name it. Basically like a 19th century pulp novel about knights and shining armor, parodied. But many of these things look outlandish, ridiculous. In a this couldn't happen here kind of fashion. Like when Trump first came to power and said, yes, in fact, I didn't mean that when I said I want to get rid of these 11 million people who are in this country without documents. I'm not just saying that I want to discourage future undocumented immigration or find a way of integrating these people here. No. It became government policy to remove people who were from the wrong sort of countries and who were in the country with without documentation. This included, in many cases, revoking naturalization, coming for families, in one case of an Islamist terrorist, estranged, distant relatives who had been living peacefully in Utah for a decade or more, were deported and stripped of their citizenship because this cousin they'd never met had done something on the East Coast. A doctor who had been a pillar of the community, pediatrician, I want to say, or family practitioner, with a wife and children in a small town in Ohio, none of the neighbors had a bad word about him per se, had dotted an I wrong or crossed a T wrong on an application some years ago and was deported and was stripped of his residential status. When asked, and in many of these cases, nobody asked, when asked by the New York Times, the authorities in charge said, no, this wasn't a mistake. This deportation was consistent with the goals of the administration. In other words, what we're doing here is ethnic cleansing. Stop us if you think you can. So you don't have to wait around to see if maybe this will turn into full-on fascism. It satisfies enough criteria so that it should trigger, in my mind, as somebody who grew up in Germany, a response that says, and now we are going all out in the defense of democracy to eradicate this ideology and the organizations that promote it, as well as the economic basis of the powers that be that finance them. In other words, you would want to use repressive means to safeguard democracy against those who would want to undermine it. We might want to revisit this thought, but that is what he's saying here. Whoever does not fight the reactionary measures at this point is not in a position to prevent the victory of fascism, and on the contrary, facilitates that victory. So it's been 6 years since the rise of Trump. There has not been, outside of the three liberal individuals who I cited, much of an effort to analyze this from that lens of saying this is fascist. For the three historians and philosophers and whatnot who I cited, they too do not have a strategy. They do not have a political response. They have the analysis, and that's that. What do you do from that point on if you do realize that you are on a path to fascism? In Germany in the 1930s, the Social Democrats, where they had power, time and again said, well, our whole thing is to govern within the confines of legality and constitutionality. That is probably going to make sure that we'll be treated the same way. If we stick to these rules, if we enforce them equally against everybody, if we confiscate the occasional Nazi paper that had called for violence, along with all the communist papers, surely even the worst Nazis will see that we're reasonable in our administration of the political apparatus and our defense of good order in this nation. But that's not the point. I mean, appeasement is only going to make them stronger. Time and again, to say, yes, you are contributing legitimately to this political discourse is sending the message that, yes, this is something you can and should say. And when it comes to social Darwinism, when it comes to the idea that somebody else's death and disease is not my problem, and if they can't survive it, it's their own damn fault, and maybe it'll just whittle down the ranks and reduce humanity to a you know, livable, a smaller size, and hopefully it'll hit the right kind of people, was a minority position in early 2020. It was frequently heard. It was never, ever in the liberal public criticized as such. By now, social Darwinism is the bipartisan consensus. Across the board, the idea is, well, you can't mask forever. You have to pay some small price. You know, there's a trade-off between freedom and safety and other bullshit like that. In fact, for the people who are dead, there is no such trade-off. They're dead. They have neither freedom nor safety. There is an absolute right, again, to cite Hegel, to your life, because that is the precondition for having any rights and freedoms in the first place. So it's never a trade-off between these two things. It is always an absolute demand that if you can keep people alive, healthy, and safe, you must do that, especially if you're concerned with rights and freedoms and the individual and so forth. So there is never an option to say that, as so many people did in 2020, if you think this is a dangerous virus, why don't you sit in a bathtub full of hand sanitizer at home while I go about my daily life and enjoy myself? And then at least you get out of our hair with the masks and vaccines and social distancing and other forms of, oh, fascism, right? Because that is actually also in a whole nother way in which this term entered political discourse. So not just was the social Darwinism not criticized by liberals as a central component of fascist thinking. No. The fascists also got away with taking the term fascism and appropriating it as a combative term against mainstream liberalism and democracy. So, in that sense, the first weapon you give up is the criticism of the views, is the accurate and truthful description of your and your enemy's views. And in creating this kind of confusion, allowing the other side to muddy the waters of what is and isn't fascism, what is and isn't humane, you are, of course, facilitating that victory, that eventual victory. And this is a good example. Like, we have a death rate of 500 people per day at the moment on average. More people have died under Joe Biden's presidency than under Trump's. And the administration is saying we'll drop all measures. We'll declare the emergency over in May. And that will, of course, remove the ability of the federal government and the need for the federal government to spend money on all that stuff. So this kind of nicely segues into the next point that I want to make and that Dimitrov is also making, that fascism is empowered by economic hardship, but there is not a necessity. And it is not like we should think that the working class is suffering, therefore they become fascists. Empirically speaking, supporters of far-right ideas, whether it's the Tea Party in 2010, whether it's the Republican Party now, tend to be wealthier and more highly educated, on average, than the rest of society. So as in Germany in the 20s and 30s, so today, the far-right is a project of a well-educated group of wealthy people. Of course, they also can appeal to others. But the idea that you had in the liberal press that Trumpism is somehow an issue of backwardness culturally and economically, a problem of and with the flyover states and the people who live in trailer parks in them. This is in itself an artifact of class resentment that serves, among other things, to let your peers as members of the professional managerial class off the hook. So you don't have to talk about Victor Davis Hanson and his regular appearance in the far right press and his contribution to the rise of fascism and to the legitimization of fascism. You don't have to discuss ways in which you yourself are contributing to it and looking the other way, because you can make it a problem of people you didn't like in the first place, evil and stupid people, as evidenced by their low income, working class occupations, and possibly skin color. So, or agenda. But that doesn't mean that there is not a connection between fascism and economic crisis. I already said that, of course, the crisis is an important incentive for the ruling class to say, actually, fascism looks pretty good. Let's go with that. But it also is linked to the rise of fascism, because if people don't get the goods from a democracy, they're going to lose interest in having a democracy. They're going to lose a sense that this is something that is in their interest in the first place. So when Franklin Roosevelt gave his Four Freedoms speech and said, what we're doing in this war, why we're in this global conflict, is for freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, freedom from fear. And if you're going to fight and give up your tax dollars and possibly sacrifice your life for these goals, you can know you're coming back from that war to a country that is better and where your life specifically is going to be better. Your chances in life, your welfare, your prosperity, and all those things is going to be better. When Lincoln said that the point of fighting the Civil War against a similar foe that was motivated by enthusiasm for hierarchy, for inequality, and for treating people differently based on race. When Lincoln in the Gettysburg Address said that what is at stake in this fight is whether government of the people, for the people, and by the people is going to stand and endure, it is the same thought. A republic where people are sovereign yields results for the people if it does its job. And as a result of seeing through the Civil War, not just the ex-slaves, not just the freed people, but everybody in the North too is going to be better off, because the basis of the country, the economic basis of the country, is going to be based on self-government, a market economy, and freedoms as defined in the Constitution, but still possible to expand. And the same can be said of the other heroic struggle that this American bourgeoisie historically fought against King George and the British, to establish the principle in the first place that the people can be sovereign and can govern themselves without some king and the nobility keeping a watchful eye over them, which was not a proven principle at the time, and which was still not widely accepted at the time of the Civil War. And in all these cases, of course, you had to fight an open war against the enemies of freedom and equality, of democracy and the rule of law. And you had to do it and acknowledge that as a result of doing this, the people living under your system of government will be better off. And if you can't do that, you can't have democracy. You can't have self-government. You can't have a republic. But the democratic governments of the 1930s did in response to the crisis, with the exception of the New Deal, was austerity politics, was to throw the working class, pensioners, public servants, teachers, school children, everybody under the bus. What the governments of the democratic Western world have done since the 2008 crisis and the COVID pandemic has been the exact damn same thing, throwing the majority of the people under the bus, making the occasional promise. But whether it is that healthcare is still unattainable for most people, that there is widespread unemployment, that the wages are puttering along at a level that means that year after year, the real purchasing power of working people is going down, even before you get to inflation. All of this is going to lead people to ask, what's in it for me? And so the nefarious ruse of the Democratic Party of liberalism has been to say, we haven't done anything for you. But if you don't vote for us, it will be much, much worse, because then you'll get actual fascists. Not that we're willing to do anything against it, other than stand in this election and say, vote for us or else. But that's more blackmail than a political strategy. I mean, it works. So far, it has worked all right. It worked to the point where they did keep their majority in the midterm, congressional midterm elections in the Senate, and it wasn't a complete rout in the House of Representatives. But this will not last forever. And the disillusionment is tangible, especially among people who ended up voting for them. So at this point, what liberalism has done is essentially only things that will lead to the rise of fascism, to the further rise of fascism. Wait, did I skip something here? No. So there's a little bit of, whatchamacallit, like sour grapes, perhaps, in the text by Dimitrov, where he's saying, well, listen, you millions of social democratic workers who didn't join us when we made revolution in Germany and Austria in 1917 and 1918 and 1919. Now look what you've done. Maybe now we can join us, and together we can at least defend democracy against fascism, or take it back. But if we had had communist revolutions in these countries at the time, the power of the social forces that are now bringing you fascism would have been broken then and there. And that would have been the end of it. And I see echoes of this argument whenever you talk to people who, on the one hand, supported Hillary Clinton in 2016 and others who supported Bernie Sanders. Within the Democratic Party. So these events then that laid the groundwork for the distribution or division of power in the West in place when the crisis hit in 1929 was of course preformed during World War I and the immediate aftermath. And it was in response to the Russian Revolution, to the October Revolution and the rise of Russian communism, that in other countries, the different political forces and economic forces aligned themselves to either support or oppose this. The idea that you can have liberal democracy and that within that, you can work toward gradually reaching a state of socialism by democratic means
and that you do not and cannot and should not try to take away the power of the bourgeoisie by force, militarily, autocratically, as it were, that was an item of faith in Western social democracy. But of course, these were also the parties that had come out with flying colors to support the war effort. Whereas communism, like I said, was largely driven by socialists and social democrats who didn't want to go down that road, who thought that did we not all meet in a conference globally and say the point of our movement is to prevent imperialist war because we want universal brotherhood of proletarians and so forth? What happened to that? And then they were, you know, expelled from their parties and eventually ended up shot in a ditch somewhere. But this is what we need to revisit. So the formative period of time, and I've already talked about the German communists who were mowed down by far-right militia in the streets in 1919, who were working together with social democrats leading the state. But I want to take a closer look at these militias and where they came from, because imperialism is something that happens not just, you know, in the heartland, in Europe. It, of course, also happens across the globe. So you get interesting phenomena that are worth explaining of a black man from East Africa in a German motor vehicle in Munich in May 1919, engaged in the massacres committed by his unit, a far-right militia based on colonial troops who were repatriated. He's one of General Leto Vorbeck's soldiers who were brought back to Germany after the colonial troop in East Africa, modern-day Tanzania, that had not been defeated, that was still out at large in the field, was repatriated. And since this troop was like 90% African, you now have black men pointing their weapons at German workers and so forth in a complete twist on the imperialist rhetoric that says, you know, savages, whether they're the reds here or the blacks over there or the yellows, are all the same, and we're defending Western civilization against them. So you can't really get at what this is about if you cannot talk about the imperial component and the actual people who go out there and work with, but also against a colonized population. That's it for today. It's unfortunately out of time.